Mr. Speaker, Premier Victoria, Leader of the Opposition, all members of the Legislative Assembly, Rosie, Christy, and all other victim survivors here. I both personally and as a representative of No to Violence and the Men's Referral Service feel deep appreciation for the opportunity to be here today in Parliament and on Wurundjeri land. Wurundjeri traditional and sovereign land as part of the Kulin Nation. I'm aware that I could only be here because of the incredibly brave and courageous efforts of so many women over decades to fight for safety, for dignity, for themselves, their families and for others. These include women who went to extraordinary efforts to establish the first safe houses and refuges against a firmly entrenched patriarchal orthodoxy, and sometimes at great risk and personal cost to themselves. The methods that these women used, while non-violent in the face of so much hostility against them, weren't always quiet, polite, or genial. They had no choice. Women were not listened to. Women were not believed. Parliaments like this across the world are always coming to grips with community constituents, pushing for their experiences of discrimination, marginalisation, and injustice to be heard. And for many, the stakes are high. Even when it's not a matter of life and death, which of course it is for so many women and children experiencing family violence, it can be a matter of lifelong suffering or freedom from that suffering. A psychological, physical, economic, and spiritual straitjacket over their lives, or the freedom to think, grow, be, connect, and indeed to fall in love with this precious life of ours. This is what family violence does. It's not just about the hitting or the name calling. It's a systematic, intentional, patterned use of a range of coercive controlling tactics to limit family members' lives, to limit freedom. It's one of the most potent and widespread constraints on our freedom in our time. This Parliament, you're taking an amazing step today to come to grips with this huge and very grave issue. With your colleagues in the Legislative Council, you have heard from Christy, you have heard from Rosie Batty. You know, Rosie is a woman, a mother, a person who has endured and continues to endure an almost unimaginable loss. We hear the fear of so many victim survivors who my colleagues have talked about today, that ongoing fear and the way it touches so many aspects of their lives. With Rosie, the depth of your love for Luke, of your unstoppable determination for Luke not to have died in vain, creates a massive possibility, a massive space for hope. A space where we together over the coming generations can end the tyranny and terror of family violence. Rosie and Christy and others deserve not just to be heard, like the hundreds and thousands of other Victorian women, children and men experiencing family violence, and it is hundreds of thousands at this point of time. They need to be deeply listened to, a listening with the heart and the head, a listening with self-awareness, a listening that we know is deep because it feels uncomfortable. According to our watch, the evidence demonstrates that 95% of all family violence is committed by males. Most of this violence committed by men targets women and children, the vast majority of it. But we do know that men can be victims too, often from other male family members. This perpetration of family violence is a choice. It's a series of choices, a series of decisions to physically, emotionally, psychologically, socially, spiritually control and shut down someone else's life. These are dark choices that men are making. The work of men's behaviour change programs and other perpetrator interventions is to try to help men make different choices about how to think and how to behave towards family members. But as a friend of mine implores us to consider through his upcoming production, World of Men, who and what creates the dark places where men choose to hurt their families? This is an uncomfortable question, but one that needs to be asked. Men's Behaviour Change Program providers, who are part of the organisation that I work for, No to Violence, or members of that organisation, have worked with tens of thousands of perpetrators over the last 20 plus years. Our men's referral service has taken over 50,000 calls, mostly from men who are perpetrating violence. And across this enormously varied circumstances of these men perpetrating violence, we find a pattern of thinking where men feel justified to dehumanise, disrespect, ignore, dismiss, and make invisible their current or former partner, and sometimes also their children. They feel entitled to control and entitled to punish. It would be convenient for us to think that this sense of entitlement is just a product of warped individuals. But there are just too many otherwise decent, well-functioning, respected men who use violence for this to be so. Many men choose not to use violence against family members. However, I believe all men contribute to the dark places in which some men choose to do so. When I instantaneously judge a woman who I've met for the first time by her looks or physical appearance, not just a noticing, but judging her, I'm contributing to a culture of sexism and objectification of women, that women are not as competent as men. When I leave most of the emotional heavy lifting in my relationship with my partner to her, I'm contributing to both an unnegotiated burden of responsibility that she bears, and I'm also contributing to a very narrow definition of what it means to be a man. When only 2% of employees in the early learning and childcare industry are male, we send potent messages that the primary role of a real man is not one of caring for children. When our boys and young men receive so many messages from so many sources that being a real man means being tough, superior, in control, not feminine, not gay, the seeds are sown for some of these men to perform these expectations super well by being the violent and coercive top dog in their family. When we turn a blind eye to the mainstreaming of patriarchal and violent pornography, we contribute to a rape culture that some men who use violence draw from in how they view, objectify, and make women invisible. This is what helps to create the dark places through which some men choose to use violence. And I believe that all of us men are complicit in this. We are all shaped by, and in turn help to shape, the cultures, media, expectations, and institutions that dominate the story of what it means to be a real man. We shape a culture of entitlement. We shape the thinking, the justifications, the excuses that perpetrators draw upon to control and hurt family members. Now, this is not about making us men feel guilty or ashamed. It's about becoming aware. As another friend of mine describes, it's about tuning our gender antenna. It's about noticing how, as men, we use our gendered power. The spaces we take, and the spaces we take over, the spaces we limit for others, the invisible and unnegotiated burdens of responsibility we place on women. And it's about our lives as men as well. The opportunity for us to fall in love with his precious life by becoming much more than the narrow real man. It's our opportunity to get to really and deeply know our children, their friendships, what matters to them. To feel okay about being vulnerable, to care and allow ourselves to be cared for, to feel the we, not just the I, that needs to achieve or conquer. Changing the story of what it means to be a real man, listening deeply to the experiences of women, and trying to undermine cultures of male entitlement. This won't end family violence in a decade. It's an intergenerational struggle. And as vital as all of that is, in the meantime, we do need to develop, as we've heard today, much stronger webs of accountability for perpetrators. Child protection workers, health sector practitioners, police, courts, corrections, specialist women's family violence services, men's behaviour change programs. We all need to work much more closely together to engage perpetrators and to assess and manage risk in an ongoing way. This is about information sharing. It is about joined up data systems. It's about clearly defined and articulated and agreed upon roles and responsibilities at the local, regional, and statewide whole of government levels. It's about working together to keep the perpetrator within view. It's about respectful and persistent engagement with these men and the right balance and interplay between justice system and community sector responses. Today is a landmark event, just as yesterday has been. It's a watershed for all of us as individuals, for the Parliament, and for all of our collective efforts to prevent and respond to family violence. Let's use this as an opportunity to deepen our understanding of what it means to be allies in this struggle for freedom. Thank you.